Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Santa Barbara Maritime Museum. My name is Greg Gorga, Executive Director. I want to thank you all for being here. Another packed house. I think we have some folks upstairs in the theater as well, the Munger Theater. Welcome up there as well. I want to acknowledge our board members who are here tonight. So if all of you can just raise your hand, members of the Santa Barbara Maritime Museum Board. Yes, thank you. And I believe I have two past board presidents here, the amazing Jean Schuyler, and yes, always a pleasure. And Ken Clements is here too, who got kicked off the board because he hired me. Yes, thank you. Since we have an overflow crowd, we are making use of our new projection system, and I wanted to thank the folks who made that possible this past spring, and that is the County of Santa Barbara through the CREF grant, Ken and Charlotte Richardson, and Richard and Mary Compton. So thank you very much to them. Our sponsors tonight are John Woodward, Silvio DiLoreto, the Santa Barbara County Arts Commission, with additional support from the Montecito Journal, Giordano's, and D'Angelo's Bakery. So let's hear it for all of them. And we are, thanks to a grant from the County of Santa Barbara, we are recording this lecture. It'll be on TV Santa Barbara, and it'll be on our website in a few weeks once they get it all edited and everything. So it is being recorded, so if you're not supposed to be here tonight, don't look back. And I just wanted to tell you about some upcoming events. Actually, we have a wonderful exhibit. It's on display upstairs, hopefully while you're upstairs for the reception. Those of you who are here for the reception got a chance to look at it. It's our new art exhibit. It's called Divergent Focal Planes on the Channel from Dark Room to Light Room, featuring the photography of Dennis Schutt and Robert Watt. If you haven't been up there, it's amazing. I think there's a very serious black and white photography of our channel, and then very whimsical photography and very creative. That'll be on display through December. We have has anybody been here at 3 o'clock during the week, the last few weeks, to see one of the musterings with the Spirit Program? Mark, yeah. So we have the, if you look out the front door at the end of the channel on the right-hand side at the end of Marina One on an end tie is the Spirit of Dana Point. It's a tall ship up here from the Ocean Institute. It's here for 5 weeks. You can get on board on this Saturday for the Harbor and Seafood Festival, I think from 11 to 3 o'clock, and do a dockside tour of it. We bring it up here every year. We put local fourth graders who are studying their California history on board for the night. They read a book called 2 years, 2 years in front of the mast. Thank you. 8 years, you think. I'm a little, I was on a boat for 4 days, so I'm a little wobbly. I just got off yesterday, so wow. 2 years before the mast, that's what it was, by Richard Henry Dana. They read that book, they're studying their California history, and they spend the night living the life of an 1830s sailor. So that program is, we do that free of charge to our Title I schools, made possible through the donations of our local foundations, donors, and members like many of you out in the audience. So thank you very much for that. The kids are just having a grand time on there. If I could just tell you a little story. Linda Sterling's a teacher for Peabody School. We had a small event at Don Bartholomew's house, one of our board members. It was the second day of classes. School had just begun, and she was there. And she said her kids showed up the day before, first day of school, fourth graders, asking when they're getting on the tall ship, when are they going to read 2 years before the mast, when are they going to learn how to tie knots. And she says her whole year is based off of that program. Math, history, social studies, everything she bases off that program. So really wonderful. Our lecture for next month, November 19th, is titled Beyond the Blue Horizon, How Early Mariners Decoded the Oceans by Brian Fagan. Of course, Brian, a best-selling author, has, I think, about 40 books out, a lot about marine life. So that's November 19th. And then we are closing the museum the day after that for 2.5 weeks, pulling out this 15-plus-year-old carpet and putting a whole new flooring in. It's going to be a luxury vinyl, look like a deck of a ship. And we are we invite all of you to join us on our 15th anniversary celebration on December 17th, when we will unveil our new floor, our new children's area exhibits, and our new beautiful mural that Patty Jackman, who founded the Wilding Museum, is working on for us that will depict life above and below the water. So December 17th, our big reopening reception, and we hope you can all join us for that. None of this is made possible, and if you can't remember everything I said, because I stumbled through all of it, it is all on our website. None of this is possible without the help of our members, our sponsors, and our new Navigator Circle of $1,000 or more donors. So if you're interested in that, please see one of the board members who raised their hand earlier, or come see me after the lecture. Would love to chat with you about that. Also, please remember the Maritime Museum in your planned giving plans is a great way to leave a legacy that is greatly appreciated. Now, Mr. Richard Slater is no stranger to the Maritime Museum. He's been here several times before, and he's an amazing person. So Richard's background is as colorful as his stories. He has been diving off the California coast since the late 1940s, and his studies at the University of Oklahoma, University of Southern California, and the University of Sydney, Australia, have earned him degrees in both geology and oceanography. As well, he has logged over 5,000 scuba and submersible dives around the world, and he set the Guinness World Record for the deepest free ascent without equipment, and he has authored over 40 publications recounting his adventures. Richard has also made a name for himself as a geologist, educator, submersible pilot, Fulbright scholar, and much, much more. So please join me in welcoming Mr. Richard Slater.
That was a nice introduction. Greg called me a few months ago and he said, do you believe in the First Amendment? And I said, yeah, free speech. He said, yeah. I said, yeah, I believe in free speech. He said, good, because I want you to give one in October. Anyway, I'm glad to be back. I'm a little taller than this. I thought it was apropos to speak about the Lusitania, because this is the 100th anniversary of the sinking of Lusitania. A lot of controversy. I just noticed the top up there, it says something about peace better than war. Of course, Lusitania was one of the things that got us in the war, so obviously this was done before the before it sank. A lot of people get confused between the Titanic and the Lusitania. The Lusitania was built in 1906. It's a sister ship, the Mauritania. They're a little less than 800 feet long. The Titanic was built in 1911, and it was 800 and some feet long, 880 feet, I think. As far as I'm concerned, the Titanic was on its maiden voyage, hit an iceberg and sank, and it's sitting in 12,000 feet of water in the North Atlantic. End of story. The Lusitania is a mystery, a riddle, an enigma. There's a lot of strange things that went on, and still some are, haven't been answered. So I think it's a much more interesting story. They should make a movie out of the Lusitania. You can see this is an ad for the Mauritania and Lusitania. The Lusitania and the Mauritania were built with the help of the English government. They loaned them $500 million in today's dollars to build these ships. There were two things they had to do. It had to go faster than 25 knots, and they both did over 26 knots, which is pretty fast for a big ship. The reason they wanted that is because the Blue Ribbon is the fastest boat crossing the Atlantic, and the Germans took it away from England in the late 1890s. And England wanted the Blue Ribbon back, so they wanted to build a fast ship that could set the record. The Lusitania did set the record, 4 days and 10 hours something, but the Mauritania broke it. The Mauritania was a little faster. The Lusitania was the luxury one. It was known as probably the most luxurious ship on the high seas. Made over 200 trips from New York to Liverpool back and forth. So, as I said, the Titanic, built in 1911, sank in 1912 on its first trip. The Lusitania, built in 1906, sank in 1915 on its 201st trip. So it was a much more used vessel. You can see how slender she was, and that's one reason it was so fast. This is a cross section of the ship. I'm going to have to go from memory because I can't see it very well. It was double-hulled. You can see on the bottom here it had two hulls. One of the other thing I said, one was had to go 25 knots. The other thing was it had to be built as an auxiliary Navy vessel. It was designed the same as a battleship. And the difference is they had the double hull, so bullets couldn't penetrate the ship. They didn't know about torpedoes when they built the ship. The coal bunkers on either side ran the complete length of the ship. And the reason they had them down there and running along the sides was that the bullets couldn't hit the coal. Unfortunately, these long longitudinal bunkers are wide open. They're waterproof doors, but they had to be open in order to get the coal to the boilers. The first class passengers, there's about 450 first class. They had the center part of the ship. The second class people had the stern of the ship, and the third class had the bow of the ship. So they were divided that way, not by decks. Okay, this is the picture of the loading. The top picture is loading coal. And there are a lot of chutes along just above the water line where these are coal barges. They're loading the coal. It burned 1,000 tons a day of coal. There were 195 furnaces. There were 300 stokers on board, 100 per watch. They had to keep the furnaces blazing. To run the boilers, there were 25 boilers. And these big boilers with the heat generated steam, and it was a direct drive, these steam turbines, to the propellers. There were four propellers. You can see the bottom, the guys stoking them. The day, the last trip, the 201st trip out of New York, they painted the Lusitania. Now, the war had broke out in late 1914, and Germany had blockaded. Well, I'm just turning that around. The English had blockaded Germany, so they couldn't get their supplies and fuel and stuff. So the way the Germans fought back was to use their submarines, the U-boat, the undersea boats. In 1915, there were only 25 U-boats, and only seven worked. They'd only have seven at sea at one time, so there weren't that many. And the U-boats originally were designed to go out in front of the German Navy as scout boats. And maybe they used mainly their surface gun. The torpedo was an afterthought. There are only seven torpedoes on each one of them. And the torpedoes were not used. They were very unreliable to start with, about 60% failed. So they didn't use torpedoes much at the start of the war, but they used their, what they do, the sub would come up to a freighter or a ship and say, "We're going to sink you, you better get off." They get off on the lifeboats. As soon as everybody's off, they'd shoot it with their, I forget the caliber, it's about a 3-inch gun, the gun on the deck of the submarine. And they'd riddle the thing and put holes in it and the boat would sink. Well, that was fine. Winston Churchill was the head of the Admiralty. By the way, FDR was Secretary of the Navy, and there's a lot of talk that they were in cahoots over this, but I don't believe it. But anyway, Churchill said, "Okay, we can't lose our ships like this, so I want you to start ramming the subs. The subs are very vulnerable on the surface." And so, and he also put guns on some of the boats, and so they could fire at them on the surface. So the Germans said, "Okay, if that's the way you want it, we'll shoot you from under the water." So they started torpedoing the boat, not letting people get off. And this all happened just in a few months before the Lusitania. So anyway, what they did with the Lusitania, they painted the stacks black. Normally Cunard has red stacks with black rings on the top, but they painted them black. They painted the name out. The name is actually welded on, as I'll show you later on, but it wasn't painted, so you can't see the name of the ship. Okay, this is the first class dining room. It had a big dome, and the dining room is down here. This is an artist's painting. People dress up for the going to sea those days. This is the promenade deck, which is just below the dining room, and they use that for walking. This is first class, middle of the ship. This is an elevator, first elevator ever on a boat. They had the first elevator, which we found, by the way. We'll talk about that later. This is a first class suite, the beds on one end. If you turn around, It had a seating area, so a little cabin. The second class, long tables, people sat on these long tables. They also had a dome, and this is important as I'll show you later. Second class, bunk berths, two sinks. This is the stern of the boat, and this is the second class. It looked pretty dressy to me for second class, but there were 550 second class, 450 first class, 550 second class. There are 1,200 third class. And this is the dining for the third class. Actually, from what I read, the third class on Lusitania was one of the nicest of any of the ships. They had fairly good accommodation. And this is their two bunk beds. This is Captain Turner, very experienced sea captain, was the captain of the Lusitania. That's a steering station he's next to, and have a good look at that because that's going to come back in a little while. This is leaving. Everybody showed up in their horse and buggies, I guess. Now, everybody can read this. I don't have to read it to you. But the German embassy put out this notice in the New York Times the day before the Lusitania sailed. And basically, it's warning people, if you get on this ship, you're in danger because you're going to go through the war zone. And nobody paid much attention to it. The Germans had never sunk a passenger ship. The Lusitania was so fast at 25 knots, a U-boat could go maybe 15 at tops, probably 10 more like it. So they could outrun torpedoes and submarines. They weren't too worried. This is a painting that I have here. The original's right here. You can look at it afterwards if you want, of the Lusitania leaving the dock. This artist is so good that he looked up the weather the day it sailed, and he showed rain. It had rained that day. Another interesting thing, you see the ship back here? That's a big German passenger ship, and they left it in New York during the war because they didn't want the British to sink it. So it was and the crew was in New York, and unfortunately they worked on the docks, and they thought that they probably were spies. And so people had to be careful loading and letting them know what was going on. But they're pretty sure the Germans knew pretty well what the Lusitania was. This is Walter Schweiger, captain, 30 years old, U-boat captain. And he was ahead of U-20. And U-20 is the sub we want to talk about today, the U-boat. This is a different boat. I just showed it. These are large ballast tanks on the side. And they could flood these with water so the ship could sink, and then they'd put air in there to the ship comes up. It could dive to about 50 meters, not very deep. This doesn't have the deck gun on it for some reason. Okay, so May 1st, May 2nd, it finally sails. The bill of lading lists 90 tons of butter. And there was no refrigeration on the ship in the hold, so that's a little puzzling. The last train that unloaded and loaded the Lusitania was DuPont from Delaware. And we all know DuPont makes explosives. They loaded furs on the bill of lading. So they loaded the boat full of furs, and somebody else put the butter on board. Anyway, probably this was done to keep the spies from figuring out what it was. So the Lusitania finally sails. It was delayed for a couple of reasons, but finally got going and took off toward Liverpool. Right here. The same time, U-20 left Germany, and its instructions were to go around the north of Scotland, come down the west coast, and come back and go up into the Irish Sea here. The word was that Liverpool was loading transport ships with soldiers to go to Europe. And his job was to sit here and pick off the transport ships with the soldiers on them. But he only had 7 torpedoes, remember. When he got to the north of Scotland, there was a ship, it was too good to pass up, so he took a shot at it. The torpedo jammed in the tube, never did leave the ship, the sub, so that was a failure. This is what a torpedo could do. It had 350 pounds of TNT in the head of these torpedoes, so it would make a house-sized hole in any ship. But these ships didn't sink. The Mauritania, the sister ship of the Lusitania, was torpedoed four times in World War I and it never sank. So here he comes. It was very foggy. This was the problem. Now, a couple things are going on here. Churchill had a room 40. There was a room 40 in London that was a decoder room. We all know about World War II and the Enigma. They had the same thing in World War I, and right at the beginning in 1915, they broke the German code by getting three code books somehow. So they knew what the subs were doing, they knew what every ship was doing, but they couldn't tell anybody because if they told them, the Germans would figure out they knew the code, and so they were really kind of stuck. But they did tell ships to sail around the north end of Ireland there, to come to Liverpool this way and not go this way, because they knew that U-20 was in here. But they didn't tell the Lusitania. This is Queenstown. I can't read it from here, but here somewhere is Queenstown, called Cove today. There was Navy ships in there, English Navy ships. They had a cruiser named the Juno, and it left about the day before the Lusitania arrived, and it had four Navy escorts, and they zigzagged their way out into the Atlantic Ocean. They came back, went past the Lusitania, never stopped to help, and went right back to Queenstown. Everybody was told to zigzag. Turner never zigzagged. They don't know why. It was so foggy, he had to stay offshore a ways. U-20 came around the south end, and they found a sailing ship. Well, right there. A small ship's only 90 feet. And he wasted a torpedo on her and shot it up, and it didn't sink for 2 hours. It was a little wooden sailboat. But they reported that there was a U-boat in the area. And then, heading toward Liverpool, he ran into a freighter here and tried to machine gun it from the deck gun. And the fog would roll in, they couldn't see it, and the fog would clear, they'd shoot it, and the fog would roll in. And this went on for hours. And they had real trouble sinking her, and they finally put a couple of torpedoes into her, and she sank. And then he decided, I've only got four torpedoes left. And it was a rule they had to keep two in the sub on the way back to Germany. So he turned around and figured, I can't go to Liverpool now because I don't have enough torpedoes. I better go back. So he turned around, and just as he turned around, he saw another ship and he shot a torpedo at her. That meant he only had three now. So he's heading back to Germany in this course here. This way. And he spots this big ship coming. He said he didn't know what it was. That's hard to believe because it was very unique with the four raked stacks. Only three were working, by the way. They used up almost all their coal, and so they shut down one of the stacks and some of the boilers, so it wasn't going at top speed. But it had to stay offshore because of the fog. And around noon, it started to clear, so the Lusitania, which is down here, altered course and started going in closer to shore so they could get a fix. Remember, there's no radar in these days, so he wanted to get a fix on the shore. The captain, in his log, said he thought that the ship was heading to Queenstown up here, and there was no way he could catch her or intercept her, so he kept coming west. And then around 1:30, the ship got the fix, and Turner said, go ahead and turn and take a course to the right. By then, the U-boat was underwater, But he was in here, and he wrote in his logbook, a miracle just happened. This ship just turned right in front of me. He had no plan to shoot the ship, but what the heck, it turned right in front of him, so he thought, well, I've got one torpedo left besides the two in reserve. Like I said, 60% of the torpedoes didn't work. It was a very calm day, and so the lookouts on the Lusitania could have easily spotted the wake of the torpedo. But this is 2 o'clock. You know what happens at 2 o'clock? Crew change. And so the guys climb down from the crow's nest, and the other crew's coming on. The captain wanted to get the luggage ready for Liverpool. Thanks. So he told the crew to go down in the hold and start moving luggage. There was nobody in the crow's nest. Nobody saw the torpedo coming until it was just, they could have easily turned and got out of the way. The ship was that fast. And it was so calm, you could see it a mile away probably, the wake of the torpedo. So the torpedo hit right below the bridge on the starboard side. Made a huge splash. And one of the mysteries now is about 15, 20 seconds later, there was a second explosion. And the feeling has always been that that second explosion is what sank it. But it's very controversial. A lot of people thought there were two torpedoes, but there weren't. There was only one. It hit in the only place there's a cross barrier in the ship for strength, and it totally took that out. The longitudinal bunkers with the coal in them, remember, running along the whole length of the ship. All the watertight doors were open because they had to get the coal to the furnaces. It put a big hole. This is just to show you some of the places here on the ship, the bridge. Is there number 8 or something right here? This is where Alfred Vanderbilt was standing, and people saw him, and he helped some women get in a boat, but he never tried to get in the boat himself, and of course he disappeared on the wreck. Here's the crow's nest. And a guy was climbing up just after 2 o'clock, and someone on the deck shouted torpedo, and he radioed the bridge and said there's a torpedo, but there's nothing they could have done about it. This is where the torpedo hit. This is a sketch of what it did. Put a huge hole in the side of the ship. Took the rivets out in a large area around it. Now the ship's going 20 knots at least, and all of a sudden this big hole appears. So guess what happens? The water rushes in. 1,000 tons a second, which is mind-boggling. The water's pretty heavy, but the water rushed in. Where'd it go? It went right down the whole length of the ship. There's nothing to stop it. So it went for about 2 miles, and it was just going under to the right and going down. And this is an artist's sketch of it. I just noticed looking at these today, the captain standing up here somewhere in the painting. This guy's a great artist. And this is very authentic. I didn't talk about the lifeboats. There are 22, I think, lifeboats. And they put extra ones on after the Titanic disaster, so they had plenty of lifeboats. But you see the angle the ship was on. The lifeboats on the port side were banging into the side of the hull. The lifeboats on the starboard side were swinging out too far, people couldn't get in. Out of the 22 boats, only 6 got launched. That's an artist's picture of, you know, boats fell on top of people, and it was kind of a panic. The ship sank somewhere between 12 and 15 minutes. The Titanic took over 3 hours. It let Leonardo DiCaprio run around the ship for 2 hours. If they made a film of Lusitania, he wouldn't have much time. So it went down really fast. It's in 300 feet of water. Ship's 800 feet long. So when it went down, there's a couple more here. The bow, this is just the artist again. The bow hit the bottom, and the stern, the last part of the ship was sticking up and it broke. The ship broke in two. Again, this is an artist of the U-20 leaving. He was underwater the whole time. He was never on the surface. And finally, there was just debris and people in the water. Of the nearly 2,000 passengers, 1198, I think, exactly, drowned. There were a lot of young children, infants on board. There were families coming back as the war broke out, and they were coming back to England. Very few Americans, 128, I think, were on board. The water is 50-some degrees, what it usually is out here, but you don't last long in that water, you know, an hour or so. They're only less than 20 miles from Queenstown. People were picnicking on Kinsale, the point of southern point of Ireland there, and they saw it. They saw the boat sink. It was about 12 miles offshore. So they radioed in. So all the fishing boats and little boats and rowboats all took off to help. The Juno, the cruiser, was in there. It took off to help, and the British Navy Admiralty called them back because they're afraid they'd get torpedoed. They could have made it in less than an hour. And maybe could have saved a lot of lives, but we'll never know. The only good thing about this whole day was the flat, calm seas. But still, of all the infants on board, only six survived. I forget how many hundred died. So a small child, a skinny person, wouldn't have much chance. A guy like me probably be there for an hour, so I might make it. Well, this is a photograph of one of the Lusitania lifeboats. They did mass burials at Kinsale. You can see it today. There's a big statue there. New York Times, there's a couple of mistakes here that you see. They're talking about the second torpedo. They even show where it hit, but there was no second torpedo. There weren't that many dead. There were enough dead. Yeah, they put out enlistment posters immediately, getting people to join up. And remember, the war was only months old at this time. The Americans were not in it. There was a lot of pressure on Wilson to help, and Churchill really wanted the Americans to get in. He'd left this week from London to go to France to see some, review some troops. And when he left, he made a statement like, I hope there are more ships in the war zone, and it wouldn't hurt me if one of them sank, because that would get the American stuff maybe to come in the war. Doesn't mean he knew they were going to sink the ship. A lot of people think he was involved. I don't know. I doubt it, but I don't know. This was a very famous poster. It got a lot of people to re-enlist, I guess. Okay, so it's laying on the bottom. Woodrow Wilson, his wife had died a year before, and he was in deep depression. There was a lot of people. Well, most Americans did not want to go fight a European war, so it was, and he felt the same way. William Jennings Bryan was the Secretary of State, and he was a pacifist. And so people think when the Lusitania went down, it got Americans in the war. It probably helped, but it was 2 years later before they entered the war. Wilson was very depressed and wasn't doing too good until he met a young gal a year later, and then he got all happy and got married. Things were much better. I think it was his cousin. So anyway, America eventually got in the war, but Lusitania wasn't a direct reason. So people wanted to see the Lusitania. In the 1930s, this is an artist drawing again. Some divers tried to go down. A couple people touched it, I guess, but that was about it. It was 300 feet of water. Of course, it was 80-foot beam, so it was sticking up, laying on the bottom. Today, it's less than 20 feet, so it's really compressed. Different divers. So let's jump to 1993. National Geographic approached us about, they wanted to do a film on the Lusitania. And they asked us if we'd bring our submersible, the Delta. And those of you who've heard me talk before know about the sub, but those that don't, I can give you a quick review. It's a two-man sub, pilot, observer. batteries in the keel, runs like a golf cart. You charge it at night. So I was going to be the pilot, and the cameraman and stuff would be the observer in this. It works like the big sub. You load the ballast tanks with water, it goes down. You force air and force the water out, the sub comes up. So it's very simple, works very well. We've had this sub all over the world. It's made over 11,000 dives. So here we are going down the river, Irish castle in the background. There were three vehicles for this National Geographic was for a video, a TV show. In fact, it still shows about once a month. You'll see a rerun on it. People are always saying, oh, I saw you on TV. This is Jason, a big ROV from Woods Hole. And the ROV is connected with a cable. It's unmanned and no people on it. They were going to use it to film the sub on the wreck. And this is from Harbor Branch, a little ROV. Wasn't much use down there. The problem was the visibility. I made the first dive, took a photographer, and they launched us, and they gave me a direction to head, and maybe 5 foot visibility, 8 foot visibility. I had a sonar, and I kept hearing this boom, boom, that got boom, boom, really loud. As I was getting closer, I'm looking and looking, and pretty soon, boom, I ran into the ship. I finally cleared, and I go, oh yeah, it's pretty big. And the other problem was we used a ship called the Northern Horizon, which was a great ship, but we're not used to working on a big ship like this. And the freeboard was way too high for us. So we made a mat out of tires here to protect the sub, and we'd have to get in the sub up here, and then they'd have to lower us all the way down to the water, and we'd have to have people down here in a Zodiac to release us or hook us back up. It wasn't a very good way to work, but this is a great ship. It's one of these ones that have the equipment that he could move 1 meter any direction. So they knew exactly where they were and where the wreck was at all times. I'm just getting ready to dive. And there's the guys unhooking the sub. Now, Jason worked very well, except one of the problems on this ship, not only bad visibility, especially at the bottom, up on top of the ship it wasn't too bad, maybe 15 feet. It was full of nets, fishing nets. And we talked to some Irish fishermen, and they said that when they come in from the end of the season, a lot of codfish on this wreck, a lot of fish. And they'd take their nets and drag across the wreck. If they lost the net, so what? You know, they'd have a new one next year anyway. But if they were successful, they'd get a huge haul of codfish. Well, anyway, the whole ship's covered with nets. The artist, when he did the drawings, the paintings of it, had to take the nets off or you wouldn't see the wreck. So Jason, they put down, and it worked pretty good. Took a lot of the film, except it got tangled in a net. And divers went down a couple hundred feet and pulled on it and got it loose. And then it got caught again, and they tried to pull it again, and they broke the fiber optic cable. So it was out of business. We couldn't use it the last half of the trip. This is the room where everything is run on the surface, the navigation room, if you want. Okay, this is the pilot of the ROV, and he's looking at the monitor. You see the sub and the monitor on the wreck. So the ROV is filming us right now, and there's a more. This is a navigation system that shows exactly where the ROV and the sub is at all times. So it's a pretty classy operation. I was very impressed with it. And Bob Ballard and I were the two guys doing the diving. And Bob was the narrator on the TV show. Bob went to school here in Santa Barbara. We were old friends. Anyway, we made the big dive. This is the Explorer Club flag from New York. It's been on the North Pole, the South Pole, the top of Mount Everest, I don't know what all. And so they wanted to have it go down. It's been down the Titanic, so they wanted it to go down the Lusitania, and I guess it's in the hallway in New York we had to take the flag with us. Bob and I made the big dive that they did all the photography on. There's the sub right at the pointy end, right at the bow. They took some pictures here. We thought we had a cover shot on National Geographic. We were so excited, but a frog or something beat us out. This is an artist. People see this picture, they think it's a photograph. This is an artist. The bow of the ship, the only place the starboard side is showing is right up here at the bow. You'll see it got twisted. So where the torpedo went in is underneath the ship. We can't see the hole, which really, what could you do? You couldn't get into where the hole was. So anyway, the starboard anchor was still there, and we're using a sublight to illuminate the anchor here. This is another artist painting where he took all the nets off. You can see here the bow. This is where it hit the bottom, hit the ground. Remember the bow went down first? And when it did, it broke in half, and you can see the broken part here. And we actually went in here with the sub, which wasn't very smart. And we ran into a big boiler, you know, just right there, so we couldn't go very far. What's happened is the ship, the forward part of the ship is almost upright, bent a little bit, and then the rest of it, all the superstructure slid off onto the seafloor. This is the bollards, which you can see in here, and they're here somewhere. I can't see this angle. This is a wheel for the brake on the anchor chain. Again, artist's saying, and I'm in the wrong angle here, but if you look close, I think you can see two domes, the first class dining room dome, and the second class is down here somewhere. I can't see at this angle. The stacks we're laying here, they're gone. The stacks are made of very thin material, and so they rusted away. But the steam pipes that are on side of the stacks, they're all lined there perfectly. There's a skylight right here. I think the elevator, I don't know, the different stuff. But anyway, he's really a good artist. There's the station we saw Captain Turner. Plates, any wreck I've ever been on, we always find plates. Plates seem to survive. You know, the wooden box around them are always gone, but the plates are there. This is interesting. This is a first class bathtub and shower. See the shower head here? And there's a little cage around the end of the bathtub where you can stand in and take a shower. This is first class, couple of windows here. You can just make out the name Lusitania here. All the rivets are gone. They found the rivets were a different kind of steel, I guess, and the Titanic had the same problem, and the rivets rusted out real quick. So then the ship kind of collapsed. The other problem with the collapsing of the ship was in World War II, the English used it for target practice. And they threw depth charges and all kinds of things on top of it, so Ballard and I are sitting down there, and right next to us is a bomb. You know, we're going, I don't know if it's a good idea or not, you know. And I think that in the tides, it's shallow water, the tide, it just the whole thing's collapsed. The decks are probably 1 to 2 feet apart now. You know. The whistle, this came off one of the stacks. This is about 3.5 feet long. The thing's deteriorating so fast that we wanted to bring up some of these things, like the whistle and the station and some of the plates. There's a really nice museum in Cobb or Queenstown, I'm sorry. And we wanted to give this stuff to the museum because it's just going to be gone. How many people are going to be able to ever see this stuff? And most of it's deteriorating very fast. But Bob Ballard was very much against, it's a graveyard, we're not supposed to touch anything. So the owner of the ship, a guy named Greg Bemis, lives in Santa Fe. He bought the ship in the 90s and was in court, the Irish government. There's 20,000 wrecks around Ireland. This is the only one that's protected. But he finally won last year. He won a court battle, and he's going to go back out and see if he can pick up some stuff. The most valuable thing on it, we think, is the their tubes with Rembrandts, Rubens, quite a few famous paintings were on it. And we were looking for them, but we didn't see any tubes. But the whistle was one thing that Greg wants to go back and get this year. I talked to him 2 years ago. See, it's been, 12 years since we were there? No, more than that, huh? 13, 18 years since we were there. He said it's really deteriorated a lot since we were there. Now, this is a sad thing. Leather seems to last underwater. And any wrecks we're on, we see shoes. And if you see one shoe like this, you don't know where it's a lady's shoe. But if you see two shoes laying together, you know there was a body there at one time. You know, the body's gone. Maybe the belt's there or the shoes are there. And that's all you see. It's kind of very sad when you see this stuff. Now, we had a little problem, too. One of my guys was piloting it's a two-man sub, right? Well, the artist and the historian both wanted to go together. We said, no, that's pretty tight. We'll be fine. So they went in there together. So down they go, and they're going over flying over the top of the thing, and the propeller sucked up a rope, a net. And so they were stuck. So the sub was designed that you can undo the tail from inside. And so the pilot said, I'm going to undo the tail. I said, no. I said, we got Jason right here. I'm going to come over and I'm going to cut you loose. He said, no, I'm dropping the tail. I thought, there's problems in the sub. Guys are panicking or something. So he dropped the tail and they shot to the surface. So they brought him alongside, brought him aboard, and I'm really anxious to talk to him. And they get out and they're all smiles. And I said, are you all right? Oh, yeah, it was great. We got an extra 30 minutes on the ship. And he said, to save energy, they turned all the lights off on the sub. And he said the water sort of cleared up and you could see 30, 40 feet. This is the artist that did those paintings. And he said, I thought it was going to be blue and pretty. He said, it was green and creepy. So when he painted the paintings for National Geographic for the book, he put it green. And guys in New York said, no, we want it blue. So I had to go back and paint all the pictures blue, even though it was green. We went back down on the next dive and grabbed the tail and brought it back. This is the whole crew. Bob sitting here with his wife right in the middle here. This is the ROV guys. These are my sub guys. That's me and the sub. Now, what happened to the U-boat? They got back and they were big heroes, of course. There's conflicting things about the captain. Some people say he didn't realize what he was shooting at, but other people say he was pretty happy that he got 70 tons of shipping and 60 of them were the Lusitania or something. But anyway, they got back. He had a couple of more missions. And then he was in a different sub and they hit a mine off Scotland and the whole crew was killed. There were 35 sailors on the U-boat. Interesting thing is there are no bunks. They just sleep wherever they could. There wasn't much room in those U-boats. You ever see Das Boot? It's a very good movie. It kind of gives you a feeling for these guys. Now, U-20, it ran aground 1917 off the coast of Denmark. And the sailors tried to blow it up. You see the bows all blown up. But they didn't, and so they deserted it. After the war, families would picnic on the beach. Children would play on it. It sat there for... Finally, the Danish Navy destroyed it. But they kept the gun and the turret, and it's in a museum in Denmark. So that's the deck gun that they did most of the sinking with. There's a stamp, the farewell of the Lusitania. So that's about it. I'd be glad to answer any questions. Yeah, let me talk about the second explosion. A lot of people thought it was the second torpedo, but it wasn't, because we know now there was only one torpedo. There definitely was a second explosion, because almost everybody in the boat said they heard it. You know, there was some question on 12 seconds, 18 seconds, whatever, but there was a second explosion. We had some Navy experts with us on the ship, and they came up with the idea that it was coal dust. Remember I said the coal was mainly gone at the end, and these long longitudinal bunkers would be full of coal dust. And we know what coal dust can do, but, and that's what we said and have in print, actually. But that's been poo-pooed now. It just wouldn't have been that big of an explosion. Plus, it would have been damp. It would have been wet, and the chances of it having an explosion. So I think that's not the way it is. Now, what about the ammunition in the bow? Well, the problem with that is, well, first there was gun cotton. Was ammonium sulfate or something? I don't know exactly, nitrate. If it explodes, it's very bright, makes it very bright, and nobody saw a bright flash. Plus, all that was, the hold was the forward, up all in the bow. All that stuff was stored in the bow. And when you saw the bow, we went around the bow, there was no damage in the bow. There had been an explosion in there, you'd have seen damage there. So, the feeling is that that didn't cause it. So what caused it? The latest, and I think it's a good one, that cold water rushed in so fast, those boilers are red hot. One of those boilers probably exploded. That's what they think now. It would make a pretty big explosion.
Yeah.
A couple hours. The question is, what was the time between the other two boats that they sank the same day? It was a few hours. It took them quite a while to sink the first one. They were shooting at it for 3 or 4 hours, I think. Yes, they radioed to Queenstown, and the Admiralty knew about it, but they didn't tell anybody. Now, the other thing I didn't talk about was what happened to the captain afterwards. He survived. And the Admiralty took him to court, and there was a big trial in England, and they blamed him. Of course, the Admiralty probably was the one to blame. But they blamed the captain, but he was acquitted. They said, no, it wasn't his fault. You know, he didn't get the message. He didn't get any escorts. Every ship that went through there the month before had an escort. The Lusitania was the only one that didn't have an escort. Now, it's a very fast ship, and maybe they figured nobody would keep up with it or something, but they still should have had something there. So it really looks like a setup. I don't think it was, but there's so many things pointing to it, you know, that the Admiralty really was the one that didn't warn anybody. So I'm not sure. It was at least a couple of hours before. He started back to Germany around midday, I think. And to get there at exactly 2 o'clock when the crew was changing was just really unfortunate. Because if they'd had somebody up in the crow's nest, they probably would have spotted that torpedo and dodged it. Yes? Was there any international stir over them saying, oh, yeah. In fact, the, what was he, the Kaiser, I guess? He told the Germans not to sink any more passenger boats after that. He was worried that the Americans might come in the war. And so there was a big international uproar about it. Most people just couldn't dream the thing sank, you know? I mean, all these things came together, the exact spot where it hit, the coal bunkers being empty, the fog, they went in and then turned to come back. All these things, it's just really freaky. Yes, sir.
Yes, you said this was kind of one of the first by chance, and a lot of this was by chance sinkings of the beginning of the U-boat program, but how effective did that get right after the...
Well, the U-boats, how effective? Oh, they became big time right after that because they realized this was their weapon for the blockade. You know, they were getting blockaded by England. They couldn't get anything in, and the only way their surface ships couldn't do anything, so they built hundreds of U-boats right after this, and better ones, and they became a big thing in the World War I.
So by the time we entered the war,
we didn't enter until 1917, so they were going big time by the time we got in there. Their surface fleet was pretty well gone. You know, the English sank most of them.
Excuse me. This was presented to Lad Handelman.
Oceaneering, the president.
That's right, Oceaneering made dives on it.
Could you tell us a little bit about that? Because we don't know any more than that.
The propellers, each of the bronze propellers were 23 feet wide and weighed 23 tons. And I'm not sure when, but I think the 1970s. Does it say on here? 1982.
Can you hear me, hold that?
Yeah. In fact, that's interesting. As I told you, Bob didn't want us bringing any things up from the Lusitania, but we had Greg Bemis with us, who owns it. And we picked up a spoon and gave it to him. Bob didn't know we did it. So he has a spoon, too. There are a lot of spoons around. But anyway, Oceaneering in Scotland sent a couple of teams down there, and they made some saturated dives on it and cut off three of the propellers and took them back and salvaged. One of them were melted down, and they made golf clubs out of it. And another one's on display in Liverpool, I think, somewhere out there. We went and took pictures with it, I remember. But they did. They were the first ones to really get on it and do some salvage. I don't think they did anything else except the propellers. So. Oh, good point. If anybody's interested, no, I did not. About Eric Larson's book, Dead Wake. Is that, I think that's the name of it. Very good book. He's a great writer. He wrote The Devil in the White City and Beast in the Garden and some of those. He wrote a book about the Lusitania because it is the 100th anniversary of its sinking. His book mainly talks about the people on it. He goes into great detail about the passengers and why they were on there and what happened to them and all that. But he also talks about some of the stuff I've talked about. So, the interesting thing on these different books, they all have a little bit different time. You know, some are 12 minutes it sank, some are 15 minutes it sank. I forget what he says, but I'd recommend his book. I enjoyed it very much. The book that we put out is out of print now. The Lusitania, National Geographic book. Once in a while you'll see it around, but it's full of pictures of the work we did and also about the history of the book. I brought the original painting sitting here on the easel if you want to see it afterwards. It's the one of the Lusitania leaving. And then I have a model of the sub here. And I like this one. My wife can't figure it out, but I said, I'm going to bring this one. She said, oh, nobody will know what it is. This is a picture, a mosaic of photographs we took, black and white put together. And if you look close, well, I got to look at it now. Lusitania. That's the name of the ship. So because the visibility is so poor, we had to take individual pictures and then somebody put them together. I think it's a neat photograph. So I brought that along too.
Time for one last question, one or two more.
How many people do you think have visited the wreck Lusitania, apart from yourselves?
I think in recent times, now people can go that deep, you know, with mixed gases and things. So the Royal Navy dove on it during the 50s. That's when they did some testing of depth charges and stuff. There were rumors that the Royal Navy went down there and blew up the ammunition and to hide it, you know, so people wouldn't know they had it on there, but that's not true. I don't know how many people. We, in our group, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, about 8 of us made the dives, I guess. Oceaneering probably had at least that many, and there was an American that went down there in the 30s or 40s, and he got down there and touched it, but that's about all he could do. Not much there to see anymore. In fact, Greg Bemis told me it's really a disaster now. It's just a pile of junk. You know? Where the Titanic's sitting up pretty, you know, because deep water, brand new ship, no currents, no tides, nobody bombing it. Okay, well, thank you very much.